Wow. This is pretty amazing. Wow. All right. Yes, exactly. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. This is pretty overwhelming, so I'm hoping I can get through this without breaking down, but we'll give it a best shot. My name is Elizabeth Silver. I welcome you on behalf of the Northampton Democratic City Committee, who is sponsoring this event tonight. We are extraordinarily grateful tonight to have these distinguished panelists with us. We'll hear from them shortly. Each of them are giving of their time, energy, commitment, and love of this country to do the extraordinary work that they're doing. It's a privilege to have them here tonight with us. We have some other elected officials here tonight. I'll try to run through the list. All of a sudden, their jobs seem that much more profound and important. We have the mayor of Northampton, David Narkowitz. And we have ward chairs Gina Louise Guerra, Marianne LaBarge, Dennis Bidwell, and Ryan O'Donnell. And we have Paula Newland from the Whately Select Board. Thank you, Paul, for coming. Who did I miss? Anybody? Oh, my God. Okay. We have a couple of housekeeping things to say. 413 Staying Connected is one of the things that the Northampton Dems have been doing. Some of you have been getting, or a lot of you probably have been getting, the blasts. We try to provide information about rallies, events, forums, locally and nationally, along with pertinent websites and social media sites. We have a table over there by the door. Catherine Kay, I don't know. I'm seeing her hands. Yeah, she's kumbayaing over there. If you want to sign up either for the Northampton Dems or the 413 Staying Connected email blast, please see Catherine at some point before you leave. We also, over there, Jeff Napolitano, where are you, Jeff? Oh, Jeff is right here doing our sound. Thank you, Jeff. Jeff has some forms for people who have websites, blogs, Facebook pages, anything that you would like us to put out to the public. Please fill out one of these forms, and then AFSC and the Northampton Dems will compile those and send them out to everybody that's on the list. So you know where to look, and you'll get all the information that's out there. Tablers, if you have tables, just please make sure you take all the materials with you when you leave so we don't have to do that. When we're done, we need to stack all these chairs back up, so please help with that. And I wanted to give a number of thanks to people who have helped with this evening. First to Bill Newman, who was sort of my colleague in crime here, as it were, helping to put this together. I also wanted to thank Clare Higgins, who is moderating tonight, and most of you know Clare is a former six-term mayor of Northampton. And now is the executive director exemplar of the Community Action for Franklin, Hampshire County. Lily Lombard, where are you? Lily's over there waving her arms. Lily brought us all the food tonight. Thank you, Lily. I just have to say that I am so glad to have met her. We met during the HRC campaign, and many of you know Lily is the person who organized the amazingly successful Grow Food Northampton, you know, pretty much single-handedly. She spearheaded that, so she's the person, the go-to person to get things done, so thank you. The food tonight is sponsored by, and please patronize these places, Bread Euphoria, River Valley Co-op, State Street Food Store, and Cooper's, and Woodstar Cafe, so thank you for all that food. Thanks to the folks at NCTV who are taping this tonight. It is not live, but it will be taped and available, and we'll send the link out on the 413 Staying Connected blast, so everybody will be able to see this who wasn't here tonight. So thanks to NCTV and to Jeff Napolitano, again, AFSC, they're providing the sound system. So. My last thanks goes to my wife, Lee Badgett, who designed the amazing programs and brochures that you first sat on, or probably now are holding, I hope. I would like to direct your attention to the photograph on the front of the brochure. That photograph is of a sculpture that's called Freedom from Fear, and it sits in the Freedom Court at the FDR Library in Hyde Park, New York. It's part of a courtyard that's a tribute to the friendship between FDR and Winston Churchill. And while it looks a little whimsical, the sculpture was made from pieces of the wall, the Berlin Wall, and it was designed and made by Winston Churchill's granddaughter. So it's a pretty amazing sculpture, very, very moving to see it. And for those of you who know me, you know that Eleanor Roosevelt and her husband were two of my heroes, and in large measure because of the policies and the programs establishing social and safety nets during their time. Now, as our nation faces the dismantling of many of these programs, I think back to FDR's State of the Union address in January of 1941, which was just a month after Pearl Harbor attack. There were two particular passages that I think are relevant and profound for tonight. He said, "There is nothing mysterious about the foundations of a healthy and strong democracy. The basic things expected by our people of their political and economic systems are simple. They are equality of opportunity for youth and others, jobs for those who can work, security for those who need it, the ending of special privileged for the few, the preservation of civil liberties for all, the enjoyment of the fruits of scientific progress in a wider and constantly rising standard of living. These are the simple, the basic things that must never be lost sight of in the turmoil and unbelievable complexity of our modern world. The inner and abiding strength of our economic and political systems is dependent upon the degree to which they fulfill these expectations." Later in the speech, he said, "In the future days which we seek to make secure, we look forward to a world founded upon four essential human freedoms. One, the freedom of speech and expression. Two, freedom of every person to worship God in his own way. Three, freedom from want. Four, freedom from fear. Maybe, as my friend Mindy said, we should add freedom to love." These four freedoms became one of the foundations of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, penned in 1948. Today, we see threats to these freedoms and to the fragile social and safety nets we've worked so hard, so many of us in this room, so many activists, to instill and maintain. Let us turn to our panelists for their thoughts and comments as we go forward. Thank you for coming. Well done.
So good evening, everybody. I'm going to moderate, but I'll tell you, you should have the view from up here. It's pretty amazing how many people are here. I just want to note that there's room down here on the floor for some people who may be able to sit on the floor. And if you really need a seat, I'm not even sure what to tell you. You could even come and sit along the wall here, I think. But feel free to come and sit down on the floor down here if you want to come up closer. Just watch out for the wires. I don't want anybody to, you know, blow up or anything like that. That would be bad. So we're going to have, I'm not going to talk very much because my belief is that moderators moderate and speakers speak. So we're going to start. After we hear from the speakers, we're going to have time for some questions and answers, and I'll tell you some of the ground rules there. But let's start by hearing from the wonderful speakers that Elizabeth and her team were able to get to speak tonight. Just watch out for the wires. Sorry about that, Jeff. I'm just complicating your life a little bit. What? So we're going to start by introducing Mehlaqa Samdani, who has come to us as the founder and director of Critical Connections. That's an organization in Western Mass that is seeking to improve the understanding of the Muslim world through dialogue, analysis, and outreach. I want to note that she's a faculty member at the School for International Training in Vermont, where she teaches conflict transformation and peace building. She's also done work to address sectarian violence in Pakistan with the Karuna Center. She's a published writer, a graduate from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy, and has an undergraduate degree from the University of Denver. We're very fortunate to have somebody with that broad range of experience in lands that are in conflict to come here and talk to us today about the present moment. So, Mehlaqa.
Thank you so much, Claire. And thank you to the Northampton Democratic City Committee for inviting me to speak today and for hosting this wonderful panel and this wonderful forum. The huge turnout that we have today, I think, demonstrates the level of anxiety and the level of apprehension that we collectively are all experiencing about the future. But for me, as a Pakistani immigrant and as a Muslim, this also attests to the amount and the level of solidarity that exists within the larger community for targeted communities like the Muslim community and so many others that have come under attack because of this election cycle that we've just been through. So thank you all so much for coming and for being here. So I'm going to try and be very brief. Please bear with me. This is very overwhelming. I don't do this a lot with so many people. But I'm going to sort of talk about the way that the election has affected the Muslim community and perhaps outline a few ways that concerned citizens can help during this time. Neither of the two lists is going to be exhaustive, but I hope that we can explore them a little bit deeper during the Q&A session. So many members of the Muslim community, like myself and others, are currently experiencing high levels of PTSD. And this is not post-traumatic stress disorder, but post-Trump stress disorder, as some have come to call it. So how is that manifesting itself? Well, first of all, what's really been surreal for me, who've, you know, lived in this country for about 14 years, but I'm really experiencing it now, is just this constant fear of being targeted, this constant fear of being attacked, harassed, or bullied. Over the past year, hate crimes against Muslims have increased by 67%. Vandalisms against mosques are at an all-time high, with, I think, 2015 being the year that was a record-setting year, and 2016 is coming in as a close second. My own mosque here in Western Massachusetts, the Islamic Society of Western Massachusetts, has been threatened a couple of times. Within our community, bullying has increased exponentially, and not just by peers, but also by teachers. And a lot of the times, parents are afraid to report these incidents because in this current climate, they don't know who within the school administration is actually on their side and who voted for whom and which political affiliation they're with. And so there's a lot of that. I don't noticeably look like a Muslim. I could be an Indian, you know, from India. But a lot of my friends who wear the hijab, especially immediately after the election, were extremely afraid to go out in public. Even doing grocery is something that's become a bit of a challenge for them because they don't know when that next derogatory remark, where that's going to come from. One encouraging thing about in the midst of all of this, you know, sort of bad news, is that the U.S. Attorney's Office in Massachusetts has been extremely responsive and really effective when it comes to sort of responding to these hate crimes or harassments or vandalisms. both the offices here in Springfield and also in Boston have been very, very good about that. And we're trying to sort of get the word out to our community that they've been wonderful. Please sort of maintain those relations, and they will respond to that. But that sense of institutional protection that we've been feeling over the past few years is also now a little bit shaky, because come January 20th, and we don't know who the new U.S. attorney is going to be. And so in terms of how well the law enforcement and the Department of Justice will be able to protect targeted communities is also something that we are sort of struggling to understand at this point. Something else that, you know, just sort of speaking to members of my community that I've sort of found out is, especially talking to young children or young people, is just the level and their sense of utter betrayal that they're currently experiencing. These are young kids who grew up in the post 9/11 era, and so they were somewhat used to the low levels of anti-Muslim sentiment and were sort of, you know, experiencing those but were sort of used to them. But this election, where Islamophobia became so normalized and so mainstreamed, is something that has completely left them, well, completely confused. And throughout the election cycle, their sense was, well, this will never be legitimized by handing this person victory. Since the election, their level of alienation has really gone up. And as Muslim parents, this is extremely concerning for us, because we know that there are militant organizations, terrorist organizations around the world that are trying to prey on exactly this kind of disaffection and alienation in trying to recruit them. So we feel like we're sort of stuck between ISIS and Islamophobia in trying to sort of protect our children, and are really trying to figure out how to channel their frustration into something constructive and, you know, some sort of encourage them towards greater civic and political engagement. And then thirdly, I mean, I'm sure you've all heard about the Muslim registry, the internment camps, the expanded surveillance that have been sort of, you know, policies that have been proposed. And a lot of people tell me that, you know, don't worry, this is never going to happen. You can't have a registry that's based on people's religion. Well, you know, in 1942, in 1944, we had millions of Japanese Americans who were rounded up, registered, and interned based on their ethnicity, and that was also unconstitutional. However, it was done, and it was legitimized under the pretext of national security, and the Supreme Court ruling that legitimized the executive order that allowed for the internship, the internment camps to take place, was never overturned. And it was never overruled. And so one of the dissenting judges in 1944 said that this precedent sort of now lies like a loaded weapon, waiting for any hand of authority to use it. And even though many people call it bad law, it was an infamous ruling, it's never going to be used again, there is currently a sitting Supreme Court judge, Justice Thomas Clarence, who thinks it's a good law and it's something that can be relied upon. And so for us within the Muslim community, just this constant feeling of dread in terms of what if, God forbid, there is a large-scale terrorist attack, and under the guise of national security, what then is going to be justified? So within the community, again, there is this sense of especially the immigrant, I mean, the Muslim community in general in the U.S. and also here in Western Massachusetts is immigrant heavy. So people like myself and others have dual citizenship. So there are people right now, friends of ours, who are saving up because they don't know at what point they'll have to get up and leave. You know, questions we ask each other is, how much humiliation are we willing to subject ourselves to before, you know, we say, okay, enough is enough, it's time to get up and go back to our countries of origin. Unfortunately, refugees don't have that luxury. I have a Pakistani passport, I can go back. Refugees who've come from Syria, come from Iraq, Somalia, and other parts of the world, who've gone through that very rigorous vetting process, don't have that luxury to go back. And apparently, even the 10,000 Syrians who have been approved for resettlement in FY 2017, their status is not completely solidified either, and that can be rescinded. So that is currently the kinds of things, I mean, that the Muslim community has been talking about, experiencing, in terms of how you can help. I know I've gone on for a little bit, I'll try and be very quick. Every message of support, every expression of solidarity is appreciated. For people who are feeling targeted, a safety pin carries a lot of weight. Please don't let people tell you that they are frivolous, or if you wear a hijab in solidarity, it doesn't mean anything. Because for people who are currently on the receiving end, every single gesture means a lot. In terms of what you can do, I mean, my first thing would be to please get informed about the issues. A lot of the things that I mentioned, expanded surveillance, was happening under the Obama administration anyway. Some of the civil rights violations that we've been talking about were already happening, but because it was the Obama administration, there wasn't a lot of sort of mobilization against it. And so one silver lining that we do see is that this, the shock of this election, is going to galvanize the community to really sort of help channel, you know, support in constructive ways. Islamophobia was already happening. Anti-Muslim sentiment was constantly going up. So please, you know, learn about these issues, engage with them, and see how, and that's the only way that activism can be effective once you're well-versed in them. Finally, I would like to, I mean, there are lots of other things that I could say, but I know I'm running out of time. If there are Muslims in the room, I would like to sort of address them in particular. I'd just like to say that, yes, we are currently targeted, but we're not the only ones who are being affected by this election. There are lots of other marginalized communities that have been affected, and it's now, and they've shown us solidarity and they've shown us support. It's now our time to reciprocate. And whether it's the LGBTQ community or the African American community or the Latinx community, this is our time to show them that we care as well. So with that, I'll stop and then wait for question and answers.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I would note that there is some room on the side here if people want to come up and sit. I feel bad for all the people standing. But so thank you very much. I think the next person that's going to speak is Ann Lynch, who is with the the Massachusetts Attorney General's office, so separate from the attorney that right. So we're not a Ann Lynch isn't a stranger to us here in Northampton. She's a graduate of Smith College and went to Northeastern University School of Law, and she practiced with Western Mass Legal Services, representing victims of domestic violence. But she's now the Assistant Attorney General in the Consumer Protection and Civil Rights Division, and she prosecutes violations of Massachusetts Consumer Protection Act as well as enforcing the anti-discrimination laws of Massachusetts. So we're very happy to welcome you here and look forward to hearing what you have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting our office and for inviting me to speak today. I'm really going to focus my remarks on the AG's hate crimes hotline. Since the election, there have been increased reports of bias-motivated harassment, intimidation, and violence. The Southern Poverty Law Center has been tracking incidents nationwide. In its update, published on December 16th, it stated that it had tracked over 1,000 bias-related harassment and intimidation incidents between November 9th and December 12th. The update indicated that incidents or reports of incidents had slowed down since the days immediately following the election. It also went through the statistics as to which groups were most targeted in their reports. It indicated that the most incidents had to do with anti-immigration sentiment, then anti-Black, then anti-Muslim, and then anti-LGBT. The update further reported that 37% of these incidents directly referenced President-elect Trump, his slogans, or his remarks during the campaign. In Massachusetts, the Anti-Defamation League has reported that incidents or reports of incidents have tripled since Election Day. All of this is extremely troubling, and in order to track and respond to incidents in Massachusetts, the Attorney General launched a new hotline on November 14th. The hotline is specifically for reporting bias-motivated threats, harassment, and violence. We have already received hundreds of calls. You may have seen the news articles reporting that we received over 400 calls in the first week. And not all of these calls are incident reports, but we have over 150 substantive reports of bias-motivated harassment or intimidation. The kinds of incidents really vary, and we are trying not to discuss any of them too specifically. They range from people shouting at others on the street, to racist graffiti, to a handful of physical assaults. In Western Massachusetts, you may have heard of a couple of these incidents. I'm sure you have. They were very high profile. There was an incident in West Springfield where a Puerto Rican couple had their car keyed with the words "Trump" and "Go home." And of course, there was the racist and anti-Semitic graffiti on Mount Tom. So what we are doing with the hotline, we are trying to live answer as many calls as possible. It's operational during normal business hours, and our intake paralegal, who speaks both Spanish and Portuguese, tries to answer the phone. We also have additional interpreter services, so if other languages are needed, we can access those as well. After that initial phone call, attorneys from my division, the Civil Rights Division, are trying to call back everyone and really follow up on incidents. One of the things we're doing is to touch base with local police departments about every incident and see what's happening with the police report and the investigation. If something is reported in a school, we're trying to touch base with school administrators as well as local police to make sure that the incident is being handled appropriately. Not every report will be appropriate for civil or criminal legal action. However, some will be. On the criminal front, local district attorney's offices usually prosecute hate crimes. And just I'll throw in that under Massachusetts law, a hate crime is any criminal act that's motivated by racial, religious, ethnic, disability, gender, or sexual orientation bias. On the civil side, the Attorney General's office can act under what's called the Massachusetts Civil Rights Act in appropriate cases. This, like our state anti-discrimination laws, is a state law. It is not a federal law. Under this law, the Attorney General's office may bring legal action against any individual who threatens, intimidates, or coerces another person in order to interfere with that person's secured rights because of that person's membership in a protected class. To put that another way, the Mass Civil Rights Act protects everyone from threats or intimidation that interferes with your right to use public parks, public transportation, public streets, to use and attend public schools, and to live peaceably in your home if they're directed at you because of your race, national origin, religion, age, gender, sexual orientation, or disability. Through such a civil action, the Attorney General's office can obtain a civil injunction, which is very similar to a restraining order, to protect a victim and, uniquely, anyone else. A violation of the injunction is a criminal offense, which can result in fines of up to $10,000 and incarceration. To illustrate an effective use of this law, I'm just going to tell you briefly about a case that I handled a couple years ago. Years before I started at the Attorney General's office, we brought a Mass Civil Rights Act action against an individual in Holyoke after reports that he had been threatening and harassing his neighbor, who was a Haitian refugee. And some of the harassment included name-calling, using the N-word, or calling her young twin daughters monkeys. In that case, my predecessor obtained a civil injunction that prohibited the individual from harassing his neighbor, and it also protected other individuals from harassment based on their race. A few years later, after I had joined the office, we received reports that the same individual was harassing his current tenant. He was a landlord. His tenant was a white woman who had just given birth to a biracial baby, and he harassed, using racial slurs, he harassed the mother and the baby, and also would do things like rap on the baby's window to wake the baby up once it was asleep. Because of the reports, we investigated and we prosecuted him criminally for violating the injunction, and we charged him with several different criminal charges. He was found not guilty of the violation of the civil injunction, but he was found guilty on other charges and served jail time because of his actions. I left pamphlets, some of you may have them already, about the Massachusetts Civil Rights Act, which goes over the basics of the statute. I also brought a handout, a one-page handout. This handout includes all of the Attorney General's contact numbers, including our consumer protection hotline, but additionally, our hate crimes hotline is in the Civil Rights Division section. The number is 1-800-994-3228, and as I said previously, the hotline is staffed during normal business hours, and so if anyone is ever in immediate danger, they should contact 911, and obviously also contact local law enforcement about incidents, but we would really encourage you to contact our office as well. Even if an incident might not seem actionable or if the perpetrator is unknown, it is very, very important to us at times like these to know what's happening in our community, where it's happening, and when it's happening, because that knowledge will inform our future education and enforcement actions. We also specifically want to invite individuals to contact us despite their immigration status. You can contact our office without fear. We are very concerned about immigrant communities in the Commonwealth, and we want to hear what's going on. And again, thank you very much for having us tonight.
Thank you very much. Next, we're going to hear from Bill Newman. Bill Newman's no stranger to most people in this room. He is the director of the Western Mass office of the ACLU. He's a media superstar on WHMP. He has a column in the Daily Hampshire Gazette. He writes the Civil Liberties Minute. He's really just about everywhere you turn. There's Bill Newman. But I want to make a and
the, it's your friends you have to worry about.
What did you say? Bill's actually a perfect person to be on this panel because this is the kinds of issues that he's been really dealing with and fighting the power about for a long, long time. So that's what makes him the perfect person to be here. And I want to say that both for Bill and I, our affiliations, his with the ACLU and mine's with Community Action, are for identification purposes only. That we're both here as engaged and concerned citizens. I can't speak on behalf of my organization, and Bill is not speaking on behalf of the entire ACLU. Just to clarify that. But I really appreciate Bill's clear compass in these kinds of times, and I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say.
There was a piece in the New York Times yesterday, and I think many people here probably read it, titled, "Is Our Democracy in Danger?" It was written by two Harvard University professors of government, Stephen Levitsky and Daniel Ziblatt. They've spent decades studying the emergence and the breakdown of democracies in Europe and Latin America, democracies modeled in large part on the United States, and here is in part what they wrote. Donald Trump's election has raised a question that few Americans ever imagined asking, is our democracy in danger? They write, quote, Mr. Trump is not the first American politician with authoritarian tendencies, but he is the first in modern American history to be elected president. The article continues, quote, many Americans are not overly concerned about Mr. Trump's authoritarian inclinations because they trust our system of constitutional checks and balances to constrain him. But the authors then offer this caution, quote, the institutional safeguards protecting our democracy may be less effective than we think, explaining as follows, quote, the idea, an ideal, of legitimate opposition may now be changing as right-wing extremists increasingly question the legitimacy of their liberal rivals. During the last decade, Ann Coulter wrote best-selling books describing liberals as traitors, and the birther movement questioned President Obama's status as an American, for which Donald Trump bears significant responsibility. Such extremism, once confined to the political fringes, has now moved to the mainstream. The risk we face is not merely a president with illiberal proclivities, it is the election of such a president when the guardrails protecting American democracy are no longer as secure as they used to be. They offer this sliver of hope. American democracy is not in imminent danger of collapse. If ordinary circumstances prevail, our institutions will likely muddle through a Trump presidency. It is less clear, they say, how democracy would fare in a crisis, in the event of a war or a terrorist attack. A president with authoritarian tendencies and institutions that have become unmoored could pose a serious threat to American democracy. We must be vigilant. The warning signs are real. That's how two Harvard professors put it. Here's how Jim Hightower put it in the piece I got from him today. Let me guess. You've been asking yourself over and over again how our country got to the point where a narcissistic, misogynist, racist, nativist, ignorant, Klan-endorsed blowhard and compulsive liar is about to be sworn in as president. Is America really that right-wing? Has everyone gone nuts? And he gives this answer emphatically no, and he explains that in his judgment, Trump was elected on the basis of anger, and how do we address that anger, and how do we use it for the benefit of the country, not to unmoor it from its principles? I think the answer to the question about what should we do is a personal one. And as I posed it in a piece I wrote a week or so ago, what will be your answer when your children or grandchildren ask you, what did you do after Donald Trump was elected? And we need to have a satisfactory answer to that. I'd like to give some specific proposals, if I might. This is not an exhaustive list. And I think the answer is personal. And I think if Trump's troops peel away because he can't deliver those promises that he made during the election campaign, and he decides to voluntarily commit America to a war, we're going to need to have a community meeting many times larger than this. Here are some specific proposals. First, demonstrate and protest. It is the object lesson from the anti-Vietnam War movement. People were in the streets by the millions. I think that Ralph Abernathy and Martin Luther King Jr. and John Lewis, I think their feet were tired. I think their legs hurt. I think there was no clear end to this struggle. And I say that if your legs aren't tired and your feet don't hurt, you aren't protesting enough. There's a women's march. There's a women's march in D.C. the day after this inauguration. There's one in Boston. Are you going? Let me go on. Let's do that in the question and answer. Okay. Here's a second suggestion about donating your time, even if it's not expertise. The Center for New Americans in Northampton will be happy to hear from you and have you volunteer with them. Catholic Charities in Springfield is organizing the resettlement of 51 refugees in Northampton. You can call Catholic Charities and say, I want to help. I'm going to be part of this movement. I'm going to welcome refugees to the United States and show what our ideals and our ideas are. I want to be helpful. You can make that call. Here's another suggestion. We have any number of nonprofits and NGOs in Northampton, the Veterans Education Project, the American Friends Service Committee, the Literacy Project. I think these organizations want to hear from you. I would also point out, with regard to the Literacy Project, that an educated citizenry is the enemy of Donald Trump. Many of you probably know that last summer, Governor Baker deputized the state police as immigration enforcement officials. He did. He said, our state police are going to cooperate with ICE. You know, the governor's has a telephone. They actually don't pick up all the time, but you can leave a message. You can call. I suggest you might want to do that. You can support sanctuary cities and sanctuary communities. Sanctuary is a bit of an amorphous term, but I do think people here should understand the ICE directive, the protocol that is in effect now. Trump can change it, but I'm not at all clear that he will. And this is a directive that deals with sensitive locations, places where ICE presumptively will not perform or conduct an immigration raid. Those presumptively sensitive locations include campuses, colleges or universities, medical facilities, and houses of worship. I think that if we stand together and make the opposition in this community known that we will not tolerate the feds coming in here and disrupting and destroying our communities by focusing their evil, frankly, on our immigrant communities, that will be intolerable here. We're not going to stand for it. We are going to engage in peaceful, nonviolent resistance. We are going to make them show the world what they're doing. We are going to put this on every newspaper in the country. We are going to just say no to that. And I think that with enough communication, enough organization, enough people willing to put their bodies on the line peacefully, that we can turn the valley into one large, sensitive location where we just say no. The feds are not going to play softball on this. They're going to make threats. If you don't cooperate with our immigration raids, we'll cut off funding for this or we'll cut off funding for that. They'll try to make it painful. And I think it's up to us to tell our elected officials, go fight them, defeat them, and if you can't, we'll pay a price so that we can uphold the ideals that we think America should be. I want to tell you a quick story. The first time I was in an interrogation room with a client, four cops, I was in Wisconsin, and I don't know how the client felt, but I was terrified. Look, one thing that you need to do, that we need to do collectively, is for you to know your rights and for all of us to know our rights. Yes, you can carry a card. Yes, you can teach others. When Homeland Security, the FBI, or the state police, or the local police for that matter, demand that you forfeit your rights or demand that you do something, you need to know whether you actually have to do that. Know your rights. We should organize the trainings. There are many lawyers here who will be happy to conduct those trainings. Just call us. We'll do it. You should know your rights. Immigrants should know their rights. Persons who are undocumented should know their rights. This is something we can do as a community. In that same regard, I would urge everyone to be smart and to be safe. Why would you ever want to help the government spy on you? Anyone want to do that? Okay, I got that. So here's my next question. Is your phone encrypted? And if not, why not? Because, A, there are apps to do it. There are many people here who are technologically savvy enough to help you. Encrypt your phone. Why do you want the FBI reading all your stuff? It's a simple thing to do, and we should do it. Here's something else. I think we need to give money to organizations that protect our rights. I work for one of those. Fine. You want to give money to the ACLU? Great. You want to give money to MIRA? Great. You want to give money to any one of the organizations that protect our rights? Do it. But do it every month. Because you know what? Hiring an immigration attorney that these organizations can do can really help. And your money makes a difference. And it's not a one-time. This is not a suggestion for a one-time donation. This is, how about you set this up the first of the month? You give something, what you can afford, to one of those organizations. I have Jeff Napolitano saying, your time is long since gone, Newman. Let me just give a couple more, okay? Just a couple more. Oh, give money to AFSC, sorry. He was not telling me to stop. He was telling me to go on.
But, Bill, your time is almost up.
Okay. I think we all need to be community organizers. We need to organize our own faith-based communities and our own non-faith-based communities. We need to understand also how politics can be the art of the possible. Look, politics makes really strange bedfellows sometimes. But I would bet that most people in this room are supporters of public education, and they want our public schools to succeed. Donald Trump has nominated a person to be Secretary of the Department of Education that would destroy public schools. But look! Throughout the country, in areas where you might not have much in common with some of those voters, or most of those voters, you will find great swaths of American who believe in public education, think it's important, think we have to support it, don't think we should privatize it, and they can be our friends. We can work together. I don't care if we don't agree on anything else. We can agree on that. When that issue comes to the fore, we should be working with people across the United States, whether or not you think of them as your generally as your political allies. Look, John McCain, who I understand, many people in this room may say, well, he stood for this and he didn't stand up for that. But John McCain said, you know what? We have to investigate how the Russian government was manipulating the election in the United States. I think John McCain would appreciate a letter from you. I'm serious. Letters matter. Jim McGovern can tell us more about this. An online petition? You know, send an email, not so good. But a real letter, that matters. And by the way, those phone calls that you can make to the Department of Justice, they actually tabulate them and say, here's what people have called about, and here's what they say, and they'll never tell you if it made a difference. I don't know what exactly is going to make the difference, but I do know that if we do everything we can, it will make a difference. I have another 20.
I want to leave time for you all to be able to have something to say, and there's so many of you here that not very many of you are going to be able to have something to say, but I wanted to leave at least a little time, so
That's why I'm cutting you off, Mr. Newman. And I,
and I appreciate you doing that, saving me from myself. Thank you.
I don't think the next speaker needs any introduction at all. Our Congressman Jim McGovern is here from Worcester.
Thank you.
And we have the right champion in Washington. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, thank you very much. Well, first of all, let me thank my dear friend Clare for being the moderator and for her very nice introduction. And let me thank Elizabeth Silver and the Northampton Democratic City Committee for helping sponsor this tonight. This is an amazing turnout. I'm thrilled to be here with Mayor Narkowitz. I just saw DA Dave Sullivan come in. I'm happy to be with him and all my colleagues in government, and I'm really proud to be with this incredible panel. And there's not a lot I can add because they were so, I think, succinct in what our challenges are and what we need to do, and I want to associate myself with everything they said. I also want to say to all of you, I can't remember the last time I was in a room with so many troublemakers, and it makes me happy because you're good troublemakers. And I got to tell you, the highest compliment I can pay you is that Donald Trump would be annoyed. So thank you so much. Look, let me begin by saying there is something very wrong with the system where the person who wins the popular vote by 2.8 million votes is not the person who will be sworn in as the next president of the United States. And that has to change. And by the way, 2.8 million votes isn't an insignificant margin. That's a lot of people. But what it also means, by any objective measure, is that Donald Trump in no way has a mandate to do any of the things that he has said he wants to do. And I think we all need to keep that in mind. Look, and I, like all of you here, I'm heartbroken with this election. I'm heartbroken because I think Hillary would have been a great president. And I'm heartbroken because everything that I care about is now under threat. And I, you know, I had a reporter say to me the other day, he said, you know, you're coming on too strong. Don't you think you should kind of give him some time and let's see what happens and maybe, you know, and I was like, no. And I'm going to tell you why no. It's not because I'm an unreasonable person, but we all just, I just lived through the same campaign you did. And after all that he said about women, about immigrants, about Muslims, about unions, about Putin, about nuclear weapons, about, you know, everything that we care about, no. There's no honeymoon here. And he needs to be prepared for a wall of resistance like no other president has ever seen in the history of this country. And so, and so, let me, you know, I agree with Bill Newman, you know, I mean, protest. Now, someone said to me, I said that at a forum in another place, and they said, well, you know what, oh, but, you know, we don't have the House, and we don't have the Senate, and we you know, now we lost the White House, and what good is it all going to do? And there was a really interesting article in the New York Times not too long ago written by Tina Rosenberg entitled The Art of Protest. And just, I want to read you the first couple of paragraphs to kind of tell you how effective, remind you how effective protest could be. She begins by saying, Poland has one of the strictest abortion laws in Europe. And recently, a government-backed bill sought to go further, punishing women who had abortions with up to 5 years in prison. Last month, Polish women responded with a one-day strike. On October 3rd, tens of thousands of people, most of them women dressed in black, protested in major cities. Poland is run by a nationalist, right-wing party that controls parliament, has taken over independent media, is disregarding rulings of the Constitutional Court, and now proposes creating a militia outside the command of the armed forces. Now, it would not seem to be to be a government that would listen to such a protest. But 3 days later, its legislators voted down the abortion bill. Why? Because the government saw the size and speed of the mobilization and its high concentration of young people as a threat, one it worried could grow. It worked. And so we need to understand that protest works when it is done right. And which brings me to my second point, and that is we do need to spend some time thoughtfully strategizing and following the strategy with discipline. You know, we heard reference to the civil rights movement in this country. That wasn't just willy-nilly. That was thoughtful, strategic planning. And people knew exactly what their assignment was and how to protest. And so one of the things that we need to do is utilize the talent in this community, not just for this community, but all across the Commonwealth and wherever else it's needed to help train people in the art of protest. You know, I was talking to Jeff Napolitano earlier. He's already doing it. We need to help provide him the audiences to do it more, because the last thing we want are protests that get misunderstood and misinterpreted because they break out into violence, or somebody, you know, displays a rude gesture or whatever. We need to be smart about this. Smart protest works. It will help build this movement against some of the terrible policies and the terrible appointments that Trump has put forward. We also need to understand that we can't get taken in by the Trump show's distraction of the day. Not all of his tweets are of equal importance. So when he tweets that Jeff Sessions is going to be the next Attorney General of the United States, a guy with such a troubled history on race issues, on civil rights issues, that he couldn't even be approved as a federal judge by a Republican Senate, when he tweets that, we ought to understand that that is more important than when he does a tweet criticizing the Broadway cast of Hamilton. We got to keep our eye on what matters and don't keep on following him with all these distractions. We need to remind people this is serious business. If Jeff Sessions is the Attorney General of the United States, that is not only bad for civil rights, it is bad for voting rights, it is bad for all the things that the people in this room care about. So we can't get distracted. The other thing is, we can't ignore his words as just bluster. I hear that all the time. You know, just bluster. No, it's not just words. When he says he wants to create a Muslim registry, we ought to believe him. When he says he wants to overturn Roe versus Wade, we ought to believe him. I mean, we can't possibly know what's going through that brain of his. But I do know this. He made promises during the campaign that I found obnoxious and horrifying. And so it's not just bluster. Those words have real consequences. We need to focus on policy and governing. And that means we're all going to have to become well-versed in terms like reconciliation. And we have to understand that we're going to have to come up with target lists for members of the House and members of the Senate. You know, all we need to do is peel three senators off from a vote, and we win. So, you know, we don't have to take the whole Republican caucus on. We just got to target, you know, where we think we can make a difference. The same in the House. We have to be smart about this. When we're proposing alternatives and how we're going to, you know, come up with alternatives, we have to remember it's still the economy, stupid. I don't care what anybody says. There are a lot of people in this country who are still going through economic anxiety. They're looking to us to be a voice for reason, to be their voice. Donald Trump tapped into that anger. He sold them a false bill of goods, those who voted for him, because of the economy. We need to now remind them of what he really is all about. I also agree with Bill Newman about the fact that I think we all got to protect our technology. Look, I've been in Congress long enough. I lived through the Patriot Act. You all know the massive government, U.S. government surveillance that went on probably all of you, right? And we took steps to try to reel it in. There's nothing that indicates to me that Donald Trump wouldn't want to do just the opposite and open that all back up again. He wants to know exactly what you're thinking, and he wants to know what the opposition might do to confront some of his policies. The other thing is we need to prepare for retaliation, and we need to support those who suffer it, regardless, of whether they're on our side of the opposition. When he went after Boeing on the price of a new Air Force One, I actually said, well, you know what, maybe it is too expensive, until I realized that he went after it, not because of that, but because the head of Boeing criticized him earlier in an interview. This is the kind of man he is. He went after the head of the Steelworkers Union when the Steelworkers Union down in Indiana basically reminded everybody that this so-called deal regarding Carrier was a fraud. But he went after him very personally. And what we're finding out is when he goes after people personally, they get death threats. So we need to be prepared to stand with anybody who he goes after, any institution, any group, any university, any church, you know, anybody. And within the immigrant community, I mean, we need to be prepared here for a real sanctuary movement. I lived through the sanctuary movement in the 1980s. I worked for a congressman who helped provide protection to all these Central American refugees coming into the United States. We wrote the Temporary Protected Status Act. But the churches and the synagogues that actually helped form the backbone of the sanctuary movement, we need to rebuild that just in case. Because sanctuary for people who are fleeing means that they're going to have a place to live. So I tell people all the time, my office is a sanctuary for anybody who's vulnerable or anybody who feels threatened, including immigrants. But in reality, you can't live in my office because, you know, there isn't a kitchen. So we need to kind of build these infrastructures and make sure that they're in place. So look, I'm just going to close by saying this. I wish things turned out differently. But I will tell you, and I know you feel the same way, this is our country, you know, and I love it too much to let it go down the tubes at the hands of a demagogue, at the hands of a charlatan like Donald Trump. We're going to fight him, and we're going to stand together, and we're going to do it effectively, and we're going to be smart about it, and we are going to have more victories than he's going to know what to do with. He has no idea, the opposition out there. I look forward to working with all of you.
Okay. So I think we heard a bunch of different perspectives that we all have the same job, to take care of each other and to fight what's going on in this country. No matter which person spoke, they were saying one of those two things. So we have time for some questions, not a lot. We were initially going to try to do some questions because we didn't think we'd have. I think this is about the size of the town of Goshen in this room right now. So we didn't think we would have an entire town in the room. But so I'm not sure we're going to have a lot of time for questions. But so what I guess what I'm going to ask is for each of you to commit here to do one thing, whatever that one thing is. If there's time at the end, we'll try to do a quick round robin of people just shouting out one thing. But if you're coming up to the mic with a question, I want to be really, of course, I have my phone password protected and locked down and everything else, so now I can't find what I was going to tell you about the questions, but here we go. It has to be a question. There's a lot of people here tonight. It has to really be a question, not, I live in the Valley. I know how it works, okay? It has to be a question, and a question ends with a question mark, not just your voice going up at the end of a monologue. Okay, so that's number one. Number two, it shouldn't be longer than 30 seconds. Number three, it has to be relevant. And if you can, direct it to a specific panelist, and don't repeat a question that's already been asked. If you agree with somebody that asked a question, that means you are a very virtuous person. You don't also have to ask the same question. So there's a mic here, and people can come up and ask a question, okay? And we're going to start with you. And I'm going to be a little bit heavy-handed because there's so many people here, and I'm hoping that I have the support of the group to be a little bit heavy-handed. Okay, I'm not going to be a bully. I'm just going to be a little heavy-handed. Okay. It will be on.
Thank you. Congressman McGovern, could you please talk about climate change? The physics won't wait. The physics won't wait. Do you have any really good ideas about what we can do about that?
Yeah, the thing I would suggest in the short term is do everything we can to oppose his nomination for EPA administrator by giving some support to our senators and finding out whether or not there are whether you have you could write them or call them, but also find out, do you have relatives in other states, and ask them to do the same thing. The guy he appointed as EPA administrator is one of the worst climate change deniers in the history of the civilization of humankind. He does not deserve to be here. We got to fight these. And by the way, I just want to say, I see my friend Paki Whelan here. I want to thank, speaking about protecting the environment and clean water, I want to thank her and others who went to Standing Rock, and the protests there worked. You know, we got to make sure that it stays in place.
This is for the congressman as well. Sanctuary areas and sanctuary cities. Two-part question. Can the government really stop federal funding for areas that do that? I mean, we all pay our federal taxes. Isn't that some of that money? Aren't we entitled to that? And the other part of that question is, if indeed that can happen and they take funding back from our Commonwealth or certain towns, can our Commonwealth stand the gaff? How would we make up for what would be lost?
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, look, I think it's very difficult to be able to target universities or, you know, particular cities. And, I mean, I don't know. The mayor may have a better idea. I don't know, you know, what funds would be targeted in Northampton except funds that help mostly people who are vulnerable and struggling. Community development block grant money. I mean, I think that's going down that road would be very, very dangerous. But, look, you can't put anything past these guys. I think the important thing is, as you've heard everybody here say, I think we just got to stand together. I mean, the worst thing we can do is all get weak-kneed, and when the first threat of taking away funds from a city or from a university, we all cave, then they win. I don't think they have the ability to follow through in the way that they have threatened. So we need to stand together, and I think you need to give your politicians in Washington a little bit of backbone, too, to make sure that they don't feel so lonely.
This question's for Ms. Samdani. Is there active organizing taking place right now for people in the community to assist minority communities being bullied, to go grocery shopping, to go to the library with some of these kids?
That's a great question. None that I'm aware of currently. We are trying to get the word out. We're trying to get the Muslim community to mobilize as well. I think one thing that this election has done for the Muslim community, which sometimes tends to be a bit insular, again, because we are an immigrant-heavy community, we tend to sort of stay to ourselves and don't really actively participate. But I think that's happening now. We're trying to sort of organize within the community, setting up a Muslim youth club that we've just set up in the wake of this election to start to get young people to talk about some of their grievances and how what they're experiencing, and also trying to give them specific skills in strategizing and how to combat some of what they're experiencing in nonviolent ways. Absolutely. But I mean, and they've really come out with a, you know, great show of support. So many churches, so many synagogues, so many members of the larger community have reached out, but not specifically in terms of providing sort of physical safety to communities. But I think that's a great idea. Thank you.
Yeah. Congressman Jim McGovern, how can we affect the state seats in other states, affect who's running for their House and their Senate? Is there anything we can do?
I mean, how you can help good people and
bad people? How can we, like Massachusetts, we have a great Democratic House and Senate, but in other states, if we want to target their elections and help get more Democratic candidates in, can we do?
First of all, everybody here deserves a lot of credit because you help elect a Democratic congresswoman and a Democratic senator and you help Hillary win New Hampshire. That's one of the things you did. So you're already doing that. So it's how we take this show on the road a little bit more. I think what we need to do, and we're going to develop this in the coming weeks, is to develop a target list of who are the most, you know, who are the people we think you can swing, and where that attention ought to be. Because again, we have limited resources and limited time, and these nominations or the first battle, these for the cabinet, we need to be ready to go immediately. So we want to have that targeted. So we're gonna. I'll talk to Elizabeth. We can maybe figure out at some point there needs to be some sort of a page for people to get the most up to date news on what's happening, that we know is not fake news, that we know is real news, and a calendar of events so that people know how to participate, whether it's something locally or whether it's something in Boston or at Trump Tower, and we're going to work with you on that. Or someone you can even donate. Right.
So this is to the great women, the women who are coming together against the election of Donald Trump, and the men, I'm sure, who are going to be in this as well. I've asked the town committee members via email why. I've Googled it. I can't find out why. Nobody can tell me why a protest is happening the day after the inauguration. Why are we not all there the entire week before? I mean, I'll bring a chair and sleep in on the sidewalk in between walking through the traffic. Okay. Anybody?
Got your question. I hear the question, and I'm pretty sure there's going to be people there. I think there was a decision made in a town that's very tightly wound up with lots of police officers and lots of everybody else there. And I heard Congressman say this before, to demonstrate in a way that doesn't get us people mad at us for the way we demonstrated and keeps our eye on the prize. So I don't disagree with you necessarily, but the people who are organizing this march made a decision to color within the lines.
Okay,
and I think
cool.
For right now, maybe that's okay. Okay?
That's okay.
Is that
I
a fair assessment of it? They're trying to figure out how to do it in a way that doesn't take our eyes off the fact that we're demonstrating against him.
Okay?
Thank you.
Hi. I'm a fourth grade teacher, and I don't want my classroom to be a place of indoctrination into my own political leanings. But as it was just said, a well-educated electorate is the enemy of Donald Trump and all Republicans, the Massachusetts and Common Core state standards leave small windows to address these kinds of topics, but where does my need to teach children kindness, self-reliance, and skepticism balance with the future that they're facing? To claim scientific facts as real is now becoming very political. How do we protect the children and education in general? They're interested and or afraid, and this is for anybody who wants to answer.
Look, I think that local control of our school systems is vital. And I think that with the election in Massachusetts, we've just said public schools matter. We're going to support them. And that's how Massachusetts is going to educate our children. I think that the ability to go outside of Common Core and to teach all of those attributes that you've just identified is crucial to a well-educated young person and a well-educated not-so-young person. It's the obligation of teachers to do exactly what you just said and for the school administrators to support you and for the community to support their schools. And I think that in Massachusetts, we actually will be able to do this, leaving aside for a moment what the Department of Education will look like. But remember, the conservatives, actual conservatives, are opposed to the federalization of education. Real conservatives say that's a terrible idea, what Trump wants to do, what his designated Secretary of Education wants to do. We have allies across the country on this. This is a winnable fight.
And there's one other thing I want to say here. So in 2 years, we have a governor's race. So don't forget that. And the second thing is, on the ballot in a couple...
Fourth graders don't vote.
What's that?
Fourth graders don't vote. I'm thinking.
Yeah, but we do. But wait a minute. Yes, that's absolutely true. I've spent much of my life working with very small children who also don't vote. It's our obligation to vote on their behalf. And so the point I'm trying to make is that we have a governor's race. The governor appoints the Board of Education in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So if you care about who's on there, you care about who's running for governor. If you care about education funding, you care about the millionaire's tax that's going to be on the ballot in 2 years. So there's a lot going on at the federal level, but don't forget that we have struggles in our own state, and don't take the eye off the prize on the things we have to do right here in Massachusetts.
And working for that millionaire's tax is crucial. What we're talking about is for someone who earns, for example, $2 million a year, doesn't have $2 million, earns $2 million a year, that person will effectively pay an extra $28,000 in taxes. It will fund transportation and education across the Commonwealth for the rest of our lives. Let's go work and pass that ballot initiative. It's up in 2 years. We can win that fight.
As someone whose family hasn't been here for fewer than 100 years and are all from Europe and who had never experienced the kind of discrimination that others do coming here for the contributions they wanted to make, I'm wondering why we're waiting and we don't all just demand to register now as Muslims with deep Mideastern roots and flood the nation with a list of all you Christians and all you whites in support of that. Can we do that?
Does anybody want to answer that question, or are we going to just...
I think that's a wonderful idea, and I just like to say that because we can give them that much data, that would become ineffective. And a lot of people have said that. The ADL has come out and said it. So many civil society organizations have said it. It will be effective, and it will be greatly appreciated. So thank you.
This is for Congressman McGovern. We have all stood up as a wall of resistance. What is your feeling about the Democrats in the Congress and the Senate? Are they willing to stand now as a wall of resistance?
Yeah, I hope so. And I'm hoping that they're experiencing what I'm experiencing when I'm coming back to my district, and that is people coming up to me and saying, you got to do something. You got to fight. You can't just roll over. You can't be, you got to take this guy on. You got to take on the extremism. And I think if that message is getting out, you know what? We will be strong. I'm confident of that. Look, the people he has nominated for cabinet positions go beyond extremism. I mean, this is radical beyond belief. The Attorney General, the head of the administrator of the EPA, I mean, his Secretary of Education, I mean, his Secretary of Labor. I mean, every one of these people, the head of the Department of Homeland Security,
Secretary of State.
You know, it's endless, and I think it's so far beyond the pale that I'll be shocked if we can't hold our own in Washington. And I think people are ready for this fight. I really do. I think people are genuinely appalled at what has just happened. And there's some things worth fighting for, and I think standing up and fighting against this guy is one of those things. So I feel we will.
Thank you. Yeah.
Well, we're gonna find out, and the deal is we're gonna develop a target list, and we're gonna try to activate people in their district to put pressure on them to do the right thing. Let them know there'll be a consequence if they vote for this guy to be Attorney General of the United States. And I think we can do that.
Yeah, good evening. And this is to everyone on stage and everyone in the room. Just wondering, in relation to protesting smartly and peacefully, if you're all familiar with Gene Sharp, his video, How to Start a Revolution, his book, From Dictatorship to Democracy. If you haven't read it or seen it, I would strongly encourage. He's from Boston. He's been studying nonviolence longer than anyone in the world. So secondly, what would it take specifically to create ranked choice voting in every state in America by 2020? Or instant runoff? Jim, that to you, if you could take that on. Yeah. So how could we have that before the next presidential election?
Well,
thank you.
Yeah. We're not going to have it. Look, there are a lot of things that I wish we could do. You know, I wish we could.
Not out of debate.
Yeah, I wish we could have redistricting done by independent commissions so we could actually have competitive congressional districts. It's not going to happen with the Congress we have right now. We have some big fights ahead of us. We're going to be having to do damage control in the next 2 years. If we went back to the House, went back to the Senate, then we should have this conversation about, you know, how we can build on it. But I think that's where we are.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
I was impressed with the list of things that we could do on a local level that my friend Bill Newman listed. Mm-hmm. But I think that I personally would like to do one more thing, and I would like to get your reaction, Congressman. I intend to withhold part of my income tax from the federal government because I don't intend to support a sexual abuser and the rest of his clique. And it seems to me that if enough people do that, they don't have enough federal prisons for all of us. There's got to be 500-600 people in this room right now. And if we all withheld part of our taxes from the federal government, what will the federal government do? Yeah.
Well, Donald Trump doesn't pay taxes, so why should you? Right? I mean, but look, I mean, people got to have, Bill talked about making, everyone's going to have to decide personally on deciding how they want to, you know, stand up to what's going on. You know, I mean, people have to make their own decisions. There will be a consequence to doing that, and I think people just have to be prepared for it, if that's what they want to do.
I'm prepared for it.
Yeah, well, you know what, and then I respect your decision, so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I also really appreciated the list of possible actions that Bill Newman put forward, and so this question is for him. Also, following on what Jim McGovern said, I would love to see these things somewhere where we can get to them and have a centralized list. So my question to Bill is there somewhere where you might do that, and where would it be if you would do that? While we have everybody here so they know where it is.
Jeff Napolitano, can I get it to you and you put it up on the AFSC website? That's where it's going to be.
And can you tell everyone what AFSC is?
I'm sorry?
For those who don't know, the organization.
The American Friends Service, Western Massachusetts American Friends Service Committee. Jeff, what's the website?
AFSCWM.org.
AFSCWM.org. I'll get it to Jeff as soon as I can.
Thank you.
Wait, one more. And also 413 Staying Connected.
which is a listserv as well, so that it'll get sent out if you sign up for that. So,
hi, this is directed to any of the panelists. So Ben and I are trying to start a high school community in Northampton that gets personally engaged and invested in the political process.
So our question is, how do you see... Our question is, how do you see youth playing a role in the opposition movement starting right now?
In other words, how can we help you?
Well, first of all, that's a great question, and we need you. I mean, understand that. And you know, when you look at our history, and one of my dearest friends is John Lewis, who marched with Martin Luther King on so many civil rights marches, and was beaten when he's marching over the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma. But one of the things he points out all the time, that a lot of the people that were arrested, especially in the South, who were beaten, who they used fire hoses against, were young people your age and younger. People who died in the civil rights movement were young children, teenagers. So look, this is your country. And that you want to get involved, we want to be the wind at your back, you're the future, and we need you, and let me tell you something, if 20 of you showed up at a congressional office, that's a mini movement. You would get noticed, so anything we can do to help you, we would like to help you.
Can I just like to say one thing. I think something that young people are much better versed at than perhaps we are is social media. And I feel social media is increasingly setting the agenda in terms of what gets covered in the news and what gets countered in terms of fake news. So please use that and use Snapchat or whatever you guys use these days to amplify our voices that perhaps we can't through traditional media methods.
Yeah, that's very good.
Hi, Jim. Hey. I feel like we should have had a conversation. I've been on the phone with your office so much since the election. And thank you for being so accessible. One thing that I'd like to know is where House Democrats are right now in terms of strategy. It's got to be more than just a target list of potential friends across the aisle. Republicans got solidly trounced in 2008 and came up with a six-year plan that gave them the entire government. Where's our ground game on that front? How are we going to game the system, too?
Well, we're going to elect a new chair of the DNC who's going to have a 50-state strategy and who's going to actually understand the importance of grassroots organizing and not writing anybody off. Two, I think we've learned some things here. I got to be honest with you. I actually read the Democratic platform. I was so excited about it. I thought it was one of the most progressive, most exhilarating platforms I have ever seen. We owe Bernie a great deal of credit for that. It was a great platform, and Bernie's people deserve credit for that. No question about it. But here's the deal. We couldn't cut through the noise. We couldn't cut through the daily coverage of the tweets. We couldn't cut through the WikiLeaks daily drip, 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 where somehow these insignificant, emails between John Podesta and somebody else became more newsworthy than a speech on the alt-right or a speech on jobs or a speech on climate change. And so, going back to what was said about Trump was a master at using social media to cut through everything. We have to figure out, it's not just the message, it's making sure we can communicate the message, making sure that people can hear it. And I think that has to be part of it. Look, I go back. I stand by that platform. I think if people understood what we were about, this is what struggling working people wanted. I mean, a real strategy to put people back to work, and it just didn't get through. Russian hacking and all these new things that are coming into play, we got to be prepared for it. I mean, this is getting rough. It's going to get rougher, but I think we are working on a strategy, and people shouldn't expect all the answers to be figured out in a day or a month. It's going to take some time to do this right, but we need a good DNC chair.
Let me fix this now. I want to say two things here, or maybe more. Bill said to me just before the meeting, did I know that over half of Trump's voters think he won the popular vote? Okay. Okay, right? Isn't that right? And he, so we start. We have to start by just keeping on reminding ourselves and everybody else about the facts. He didn't win the popular vote in the general election, and he didn't win the majority of Republicans in their primary either. He didn't. He's not a winner. Okay. He played in a system that he was able to game to become a winner. And we dropped the ball a few places because Putin helped knock it out of our reach and a number of other things happened. They didn't have a six-year plan to get Trump in the White House. That was not their six-year plan. They're as upset, some of them are as upset as we are. So we need to find that space and work it. And I think that's part of what the congressman is saying. And we can never forget that she won, that more people voted for her. Because if we allow ourselves to think he was the winner, then we're not going to fight from a position of strength. We have to fight from a position of strength. And the other thing is, almost half the country didn't vote at all. And those demoralized people have to be re-engaged into a conversation that's about them and the real difficulties that they are having in their lives and the real hopes and dreams that they fear are not going to come through for their children. So let's keep our eyes on those things and not be distracted, as the congressman said, by the tweet of the day or the propaganda of the day.
So.
Thank you.
I've had both of my questions taken from me now, so I'm going to, if you don't mind, I guess the next thing I've got is I'm nervous about the authoritarian tendencies I see in the coming cabinet. I'm nervous about the crises that might be brought about and used as, you know, as opportunities to reform kind of the rules, the Constitution even. And I'm wondering how far the Democrats can go and how far they're willing to go and how we can help them go as far as necessary to obstruct as much of that as possible.
Well, I'm going to build on what Bill Newman said earlier about, you know, we might have to have some, you know, strange alliances here, because some of these authoritarian tendencies that can potentially do the most damage, I think some of our Republican friends worry about them as well. That's why it's important that John McCain and Lindsey Graham understand the importance of doing an investigation into Russian interference in our election. I'm also worried about nuclear weapons. I'm worried about the fact that the President of the United States can basically launch a nuclear attack and there's like no checks and balances there. And we're trying to figure out a way maybe to work with some Republicans to say, you know, given the fact that we have a guy who's temperamentally unfit to be President of the United States, how do we put, you know, checks and balances into place? Because after all, he basically said, you know, that he would use nuclear weapons. What are they there for? So I think we're going to find that there may be some areas working with Republicans that we may be able to find some common ground. And when we do, we're going to have to do that. Because again, I think sometimes we underappreciate how much damage a president can really do, especially one who's not fit to be in office.
I'm afraid to say that I would have used the word fascist and not just authoritarian. I really do think there's a lot of the symptoms of fascism in this new administration. But my question is, that you should know that for all the people who are here, probably twice as many people would have been here, but they couldn't find a place to park. And I think that you've got really this fantastic crowd and then another potential crowd. And I wonder whether you should take advantage of this and find out a way. I know I would appreciate it because I really want to do something. I want to be connected to other people who are doing something en masse. So I wonder whether we should take advantage of this and at least get a list of the people who are here so that we can show up if somebody says the day after the march in Washington, we should be out in Northampton streets, but there's no way, you know, a website's not enough. We need to connect.
Got the question. Yeah. Elizabeth, is there a place for people to sign up? Which is on your program. So if you want to stay connected, that's what you should do. And I don't think we thought we would get the equivalent of two small towns. One got to stay and one had to leave.
And can I just make, what was that? And maybe, Elizabeth, maybe one thing we might want to do is, you know, I mean, obviously, is reconvene, you know, in a few months just as a, you know, so we all can kind of see how we're...
In a larger location.
UMass football stadium.
We'll see how the Mullen Center is.
Do me a favor, please. I think the suggestion Bill had about another forum, a lot of the lawyers can talk about some of those issues. Send us your suggestions for forums, and we'll try to schedule them regularly, obviously in a place larger than this, and we can address all these kinds of concerns, and over time, as we see what's developing and we have a clearer sense of exactly where things are going, we'll be able to address them with some forums that are particularly relevant. So please sign up with Catherine at 413 Staying Connected, or just send an email and they'll come to us. So thank you.
I think we're going to go for about 10 more minutes, okay? I'm starting to see people leave, and I think people's it is a school night, so...
Well, you just answered the first big question I had, which was reconvening, so that's great. But I do want to ask a little bit about sort of the Gandhian approach, the salt march, the whole attacking at the economic level, resistance at the economic level. I know there was a question about taxes, but I'm wondering about pro-cots and boycotts and Standing Rock and sort of that level of things. And I'm adding Standing Rock in because of all the recent efforts to divest from banks that have been financing Standing Rock's, the company building the pipeline. Thank you. This is for anybody, and it's definitely something that could involve long-term strategy towards a real economic kind of power play.
No, I think that's a great idea. I think we ought to be thinking in terms of, we have to think out of the box and sometimes even beyond our comfort level, but I think... I think those are good ideas.
I would be willing to be on a committee to do some long-term strategy for that.
So I guess the thing is that nobody at the front of the room or in the room has the lock on the good ideas. So if you have a good idea, I think communicate it through to the listserv or through.
Well, maybe we can have a forum on that. I know right, Bill McKibben that, so and free.
Let's
you
figure
know,
that.
365.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So my question is for Jim McGovern about Standing Rock. I know the Army Corps of Engineers is doing a study. There's a temporary injunction, January 20th, Jeff Sessions. It's horrifying. How do we permanently protect Standing Rock? Is there any chance of it being declared a national monument? How do we permanently stop that?
Well, you know, look, I don't know. But I think we also have to understand we have a few weeks left of this president. And there are a few things I'd like him to do. That would be a good idea if we could figure out a way to see whether through some executive action that might be too difficult for Donald Trump to overturn, whether there could be something there. The other thing is, you know, he's got to offer as much protection to the immigrants who are here as possible. Some of us have asked him to do a pardon for all the dreamers. And, you know, I would like it to be broader, but I think we figured that these people have come forward, have registered, have gone through background checks so that it will withstand a court challenge if someone to challenge it. But we need to protect as many people and protect as much land as possible. And I will, we're going to go back after the first of the year. The president's still there until Trump gets sworn in. You know, maybe there's some additional action he could take. If not, we're back out. We're going to go out and protest with those who have already been out there. I mean, this is it's an important victory. We don't want to let them turn it away. I'll just say one final thing. If we can defeat Jeff Sessions, that's a real good start. And so that's one of the things we got to focus on.
I don't think anybody else should get on the line, okay?
All right. My name is Susan Triolo. I work with the Franklin County Continuing the Political Revolution, which is based on Bernie's platform, and we are very active. We're at the back of the room, and my question is, building on what Clare was talking about, we're all talking about trying to reach out to the people who are disaffected, alienated. Half the people in our area probably didn't vote either, since half the people in the country didn't vote. Maybe do you see a way of reaching out to people locally who are so disaffected in a way where maybe a group like yourselves or other luminaries of the local area could bring together people to try to bridge some of those alienated issues?
I'd like to go back to the Northampton High School students and say that's where the future is. You need to get your community involved. If you can start civic engagement when you're in high school, you'll live with it the rest of your life. That 50% non-participation or 45% non-participation rate in our elections is an affront to democracy. It is something that we should all be desperately concerned and worried about. And I think that engaging people, and particularly starting with young people, because you know what? They're engaged. They'll get their parents engaged. They'll get their friends' parents engaged. They'll get their communities engaged. I think I would put my efforts into young people who want to be civically engaged, because that's the future, and we can win that fight.
Hi there. I apologize if this was discussed earlier. I had to get dinner for my kids, so I was late. But it's clear from the room that the left has been mobilized by this. And I keep thinking about, you know, every time a door closes, a window opens somewhere. So what is the window? And I keep thinking about what state efforts can we get through at this moment when the left is so mobilized and we're sort of, our hands are tied federally. Like, I know we talked about the Fair Share Amendment, the minimum wage,
Act. There's carbon pricing, revenue neutral carbon pricing. What other, you know, what are we close to on a state level that we can push through in this level and be an example to the rest of the country?
There's criminal justice reform. There's closing prisons. There's a reform of the Bail Act. You can give money to the bail funds. You know, the most important fact of whether someone goes to prison and gets convicted is whether or not they were held before their trial. The bail funds get people out. 98% of those people who would never have gotten out but for these bail funds, which have been started, they appear in court. And the conviction rate has been cut by 3/4 just because someone can get out on $50 or $100 bail. That's something you can do. Listen, Governor Shumlin just pardoned or commuted the sentences of all of the persons convicted of drug charges or marijuana charges in Vermont. Why can't we do that in Massachusetts? We should do that in Massachusetts. Governor Baker can do that. And you can call him. There's a lot to be done on criminal justice reform, and there's a lot to be done on economic issues as well.
Hi. So there's a lot of things that can be done, but on Inauguration Day, is there at this point any development of a symbolic gesture that all of us, that can be a unifying moment for our country, that people are protesting in a peaceful way, like the women wearing black in Poland? It's just to the panel. Is there anything happening that's gonna, you know, the big symbolic gesture on the day, because I'm in.
I haven't heard about anything. I mean, but...
Somebody start one.
Right, yeah.
I'm going to remind us all, as an early childhood person, I'm going to remind us of the story of the little red hen. Yes. Come on. If you have a good idea, talk to your neighbor and figure out how to do it. Okay? Because there's no somebody. We now are the somebodies. When we look in the mirror and say, somebody should do this, okay, we got to figure out how to do it. So if you have an idea that you think we should all do something, send it out on the listserv. Let's see who bites. Okay? And I don't mean that as a criticism. I'm just aware that I have a million good ideas, but there's no somebody to do them. I got to do them.
Hi, my name is Camille Elliott, and I got invited here from some of my friends. I'm from Springfield. So my question is, how can all of us take this energy out of this room to all our communities in Western Mass, Springfield, Pittsfield, and what have you, and everyone be a part, even folks that are not here tonight that sort of look like me? And then some.
That's a really good question.
So Richie Neal, you know, is my congressman. If you can talk to him, that we can have this sort of gathering throughout.
This should happen everywhere in Massachusetts, everywhere in the country. I mean, this is what democracy is supposed to be about. I mean, this is the best of our country on display. This is unbelievable. I mean, it's wonderful. And so anything I can do, I'll talk to Richie and tell him that we did this and tell him that, you know, expect some calls to work out something similar in Springfield.
Okay.
Mr. Newman, is there anything that we can do in Massachusetts against voter suppression in other states, like the interstate cross-check?
If you take a look at the ACLU, the national ACLU website, aclu.org, I think you'll see 25 lawsuits that the ACLU brought for voting rights in the last election, and the personal commitment from Anthony Romero, who is the executive director, that we're going to be filing equal numbers going forward.
So support the ACLU.
I'm sorry?
Support the ACLU.
Well, I think that's a good idea, yeah.
Ethel Rosenberg of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, electrocuted, as I recall, in the early 50s under the McCarthy hearings for allegedly giving secrets to the Russians. And Ethel apparently has been proven to be completely innocent, and the Mirapol sons are trying to get her exonerated under Obama in the remaining few days before he leaves office. Trump will never do it. Ideas?
Well, I'd like to publicly thank Jim McGovern, who delivered a letter to President Obama saying, you should issue this proclamation exonerating Ethel. He's a stand-up guy. You can sign the petition. You can go to the Rosenberg for fun. You sign the petition, get your friends to sign the petition, write the president, call the White House.
We were at the end. Yeah. I mean, I said when she got up, no more people, and so I'm afraid there may have been other people who didn't get up to ask a question. No, okay, but people will still be here, so you can certainly talk to them. I'm aware of time. I'm aware of the panelists' time. It's 9:15. We stayed 15 minutes over. I want to really thank the panelists. But I thank the organizers. Thank especially Elizabeth Silver. I want to make a point here. It's great to come and gather here today, but we're going to go back out, and there's going to be people with good ideas. Make sure they get to the website and or the listserv and they get out there. I also want to make a point that there are a lot of people in this Commonwealth that depend on the federal government to keep their house warm, to keep food in their refrigerator, to make sure they can go to work and their child's child care is paid for. If I'm worried that the money spigot is going to turn off in March. So please be ready to support people on their basics come March if the spigot gets turned off in Congress, because there will be people who will be hungry and cold if the continuing resolution doesn't go through. Thank you very much for being here. Thank you. Good job.